So I'm going to start with a very, very brief review, bottom of page 13, and we'll jump right into The Matrix of Mind, page 14. So the entire introduction, the first 14 pages or so, is basically to help Don and the group approach the study of tarot properly. And so on and on, Don kept asking, how did it form? How should we get into it? What's the proper way of understanding the different elements of each card? How can we get rid of what's not necessary? Which deck is the best? What does Ra recommend? And so the bottom of page 13 is the final summation of Ra's advice. And they said, in terms of looking at each card, there obviously were letters or hieroglyphics on cards, or on some originally, or on older Egyptian type decks. So Ra says, firstly, elimination of letters or those characters is acceptable. Then elimination of stars is acceptable in all cases, meaning they're always astrological. Elimination of the wand is appropriate. So again, getting beyond the astrological. Fourthly, the sphere held in the hand in the first card may be seen to be held by the thumb and index and second finger, the first, second, and third fingers. Fifthly, and they're saying finally, not finally, but fifth point is that there is no pure deck because there were various distortions from the earliest date. And finally, although it's useful to see the image and consider the meaning without those astrological additions, what's most important or what needs to be focused on, because you can't really get rid of all those astrological additions, what's really important is to see the general position and phase and characteristics of each card, each concept complex. That's very interesting and important. Position, general positions, phases, meaning in motion, in movement, in a sequence, where is this card in the images? And then the characteristics of each one, each card, are significant and need to be considered. So again, even the deck that's used is not essential. The Egyptian deck we'll be using, that they used in the fourth volume to illustrate, is best, but the images shouldn't be held too tightly. So let's start. Matrix of Mind, page 14. This is from session 78, question 11, the middle of page 14. And again, looking at the card, we see a male figure facing to our right, to his left, holding a sphere with a cube in front of him, with an, looks like an ibis in front of it, above the checkerboard floor, just like the Masonic temple pattern. The checkerboard floor design, you see that it's the bottom level of that cube. It's not surrounding the center of the cube or the box. It's only the bottom level. Obviously, that's a reference to polarity. The ibis, I don't know. We'll get into it all. The holding of the sphere, we'll get into, and his clothing, although that may simply be Egyptian, and headdress. So, bottom of page 14, Don asks, could you please elaborate on the nature and quality of the matrix and potentiator of mind? Ra answers, in the mind complex, the matrix may be described as consciousness. Okay, so card number one, the matrix of mind equals consciousness. It has been called the magician. it's to be noted that that of itself, consciousness, is unmoved. This is an interesting point. In and of itself, consciousness is unmoved. The potentiator of consciousness is the unconscious. This encompasses a vast realm of potential in the mind. So, I'm not going to get into the signal problem on Skype. We'll just hope that it resolves itself over time. It's good that everybody remains muted. So, the matrix of mind is consciousness. The potentiator of mind is the unconscious. The conscious mind is unmoved. It doesn't move. The potentiator of mind, or the unconscious, is what moves consciousness, or is what stirs the waters of consciousness. And the unconscious is a vast realm of potential. So the unconscious, or the deep mind, is a realm of potential. Next, in the body, the matrix may be seen as balanced working or even functioning. This is card number 8. And card number 8 is also called Justice, which shows the figure, which is female, holding a lion, or I guess it looks like a big lion, and it's also called Strength. Strength, Justice, Ra's calling it balanced working or even functioning. And again, this is the matrix of body. The matrix position is the unmoved, the unmoved starting point in either body or mind, body, or spirit. So anyway, the matrix card for body is 8, balanced working or even functioning, aka justice or strength. Note that here, Ra says, here, the matrix is always active with no means of being inactive. So the balance, the basic state of body is balanced working or even functioning, or you could say homeostasis, which is itself a kind of strength and justice. There's no means of it being inactive. So that's interesting. The body is always active in its way of homeostatic functioning. The mind, however, can be inactive, and this has great ramification for body-mind synchronizing in meditation. By mindfulness practice, we tie awareness or concentration to body, watching the breath, watching the belly rising, falling, or doing the, you know, sweep method of vipassana, mindfulness. But primarily, breath awareness is the focusing of the ever, you know, of the constantly moving mind onto the body, which is also always active, but slower, you know, and thoughtless. The nose is just the nose, and the breath is just coming and going. This is slowing the mind to the level of body, in a sense, or tying mind to body, which, anyway, let's get into it another time. It's very subtle, because in this case, the body is never non-active. It's always active. The matrix of body always active. And the mind can be non-active. We're really tying the inactivity, receptivity of conscious mind to the thoughtlessness of body that never ends. It's a little strange, but the tying of mind and body in mindfulness meditation very much works with these different archetypes. So Ra continues, the potentiator of the body complex, then, which is card number 9, may be called wisdom, for it's only through judgment, meaning wisdom, that the unceasing activities and proclivities of the body complex may be experienced in useful modes. And that means that the body is always, you know, the monkey mind is in some ways copying the monkey body, in the sense that the body manifests unceasing activities and proclivities, right? I scratch my leg, I look out the window, I move my hand, I lick my lips, I drink the water, I put my hand down, I move over here. You know, that's what body's doing, jumping around. And, you know, the mind also. And so it's wisdom or judgment or careful consideration that is the way of moving body into the experience of supporting development of awareness, rather than just being jumping around doing its own thing. How to experience the body in useful modes. And when we look at card number 9, that's the hermit. Now, the hermit as number 9, which all the decks agree on, or many decks agree that the name is the hermit, being the potentiator of body, really is the position of 9, the ninefold, the position of number 9, like the Beatles said, number 9, that was a song, strange part of a song. 9 is the last digit in the series, you know, 0 up. 0 to 9 ends at 9. And the next, you know, is a 10, which is repeating the same digits. So, the hermit, like the old man on the hill, like higher self, actually, in some ways represents a conscious, deliberate, spiritualized stilling of the body. So the hermit is in some ways spiritualized stilling of body. And you can see that it's, you know, traditionally in Rider-Waite, it's a very vertical card, right? The guy's standing quite upright. Looks like just a pillar. Right, and his head's got a pillar on the first, head's got a funny hat, and a pretty scary or weird face, actually, on the original Egyptian card of the Hermit number 9. But it's very vertical, and that is really spinal alignment and stilling body by the mind of solitary clarity. Solitary clarity is the alignment of body with spirit. Anyway, so then we go to the matrix of spirit. So Ra's running through matrix. The matrix of the spirit is what you may call the night of the soul, or primeval darkness, card 15. Again, we have that which is not capable of movement or work, like body. The potential power of this extremely receptive matrix. Oh, that's very interesting. The power of an extremely receptive matrix, right? We think of power as moving outwards. But actually, greater power is reception. Because what's being received is the totality. I mean, you know, Ross says that the adept opens itself to the universe, which it is. So the fullest opening of the self to the universe is pure reception or total reception or transparency to what is. Breaking the bucket. No longer taking from the ocean of consciousness or the ocean of power, but breaking the bucket and becoming that ocean fully. And so that power is absolute reception. So the potential power of the matrix of spirit, this extremely receptive matrix, is such that the potentiator may be seen as lightning Now, this is where we're gonna have to do a little bit of adjustment. I don't know if that would be. I guess you know the towers, right? The blasted tower. Mm-hmm. It shows lightning, but that's actually okay. That's fine. That's the potentiator of spirit. 16, 2, 9, 16 are the potentiator cards. 16 is the towers. The blasted tower just looks like the World Trade Center, of course. Interesting that the original 16 shows the bolt of lightning destroying the capstone or removing the capstone off of the pyramid and showing two guys falling headlong to the dirt. We'll look more at that later, but that really represents the action of the potentiator of spirit on Matrix. Everybody looks like a pharaoh in those cards, actually. But these are not political cards, and so it really is not talking about, you know, destruction of the New World Order. Although that's an interesting notion. But what they're really talking about is how the unmoving, non-working matrix of spirit, which is pure receptivity, right? It's the, you see, in chakric terms, the matrix of spirit, to some extent, is six chakra. And the lightning bolt is intelligent infinity coming through 7 to 6, sixth ray, seventh ray, or 7 to 6, someone coming down. The potentiator may be seen as lightning, and I would say that's the card 16, the towers. In your archetypical system called the Tarot, this has been refined into the concept complex of the lightning-struck tower. However, the original potentiator was light in its sudden and fiery form. That is, the lightning itself. Now, what's interesting is that we call card 16 the towers, the blasted tower, the lightning-struck tower. It's not about tower. The card is about lightning. That's interesting. Mm-hmm. It's not about blasting something. It's about blasting. It's about the pure action of striking the spirit complex by light, which is intelligent infinity, I'd say, in its sudden and fiery form. Yeah, you can say it's blowing up a shell, but it's really, you see, the point is that the tower, I believe, was not the original meaning. The lightning struck tower, card 16, really should be called lightning strikes. Lightning striking, or lightning strike. Not the same as lucky strike. So, card 16 could be understood as lightning strike. What it strikes is the tower of spirit, or the matrix of spirit. It's not from within. It's from within in a sense that all is in. There's nothing outside, you see. I mean, self is totality. So there's nothing outside the self. Now, if you really know that, negatives don't hang nearby. I mean, human negatives may, but spirit negatives don't hang out nearby somebody who knows self is totality, if it's really known, you know, not faked, not just thought, but known. So that's why, that's the greater power when one senses that kind of thought form, negative thought form transfer, is to remember your totality. You are totality. The mountain is you. The sky is you. The cosmos is you. That's not heresy. And that's not grandiosity. Because we, in this current form, still have distortions and 1,000 misunderstandings and 1,000 confused patterns. And you are the solar system also. Both. So, anyway, what we're seeing in these pairings, Ra is really pairing the matrix with the potentiator of mind and then body and then spirit. And what we see in all cases is the potentiator stimulates, activates, ignites, triggers, potentiates, brings into the real from the potential. It realizes its potential into the matrix of mind, body, spirit. And so, interestingly, if we're comparing matrices, the mind matrix or consciousness is itself unmoved and represents the male pole of moving forward, reaching forward. The matrix of spirit is also unmoved. It's not capable of movement or work. It's extremely receptive. So the matrix of mind isn't moved. It's relatively stable, although the conscious mind dances about. It's simply awareness, you know, consciousness, conscious awareness of something. Consciousness, the conscious mind just is conscious of this and conscious of that. But it's kind of shallow, and so it needs the richness of the unconscious. The matrix of spirit is, what is it, right? You have to, I mean, I'm not going to get into it fully, but card number 15 is called the devil. So what? The spirit complex is the devil? Is evil? No. Of course not. I think that the meaning here is that the devil comes. a more complete affirmation of being on the negative path is really done by spiritual predilection, spiritual preference. Being on the negative path is really a spiritual preference, because just thinking is not enough, or thinking I like this. It really begins when power comes in, and that's spirit complex, meaning the negative path really begins consciously for those who are affirming that they love power over goodness. They don't love love. They don't love happiness. They love power and lust for power. And that's some kind of a spirit complex recognition. So anyway, we'll get more into that, the 15 and 16, way down the line here. So the matrix is the matrix of mind and body and spirit is that which in many ways waits for the potentiating or the triggering or the sparking. And so the final sparking for spirit is light, is fiery or electric light, which I believe really is coming through higher self. So let me go on. Page 15, Don's second question. Don says, oh, it's a long question. It just seemed to me that since the planets were an outgrowth of the logos, and since the archetypical mind was the foundation of the experience, that the planets of this logo was the foundation of the experience, meaning our experience, that the planets of the logos would be somewhat related. I'm following the law of 1.info ordering, And this question obviously doesn't quite follow what Rod just said about the matrix and potentiators in that portion. But then finally, Don goes on and on talking about how this is difficult. It's difficult, it's difficult. That's for sure. Then he says, "You've spoken of the magician as a basic archetype, number one, and that this seems to have been carried through from the previous octave, meaning without a veil. Would this be in order, if there is an order, the first archetypical concept for this logos, the concept that we call the magician?" So we're sort of going back to an earlier position, even though this question comes later. So Don was very confused here. And Ross says, "We would first respond to your confusion as regards the various writings upon the archetypical mind. You may well consider the very informative difference between a thing in itself and its relationships or functions." So a thing in itself versus its relationships or functions, that's structure and function or substance and functioning. "There is much study of archetype, which is actually the study of functions, relationships, and correspondences. The study of planets, for instance, is an example of archetype seen as function. However, the archetypes are, first and most profoundly, things in themselves and the pondering of them and their purest relationships with each other," meaning the relations of the nature of one to the nature of another based on being a thing in itself. There's a German phrase for that, but I forgot. Ding ing such or something, such. We talked about this before. The thing in itself, the pondering of the archetypes as things in themselves or in their true nature of each. Then we can say their purest relations with each other should be the most useful foundation for the study of the archetypical mind. So what's most useful as foundation for study and understanding is understanding each archetype mainly, primarily as a thing in and of itself, its own essence, its nature, its substantial meaning, versus, and later only, considering relationships and functions. Second paragraph, Ross says, "We now address your query as to the archetype, which is the matrix of mind. As to its name, the name of magician is understandable when you consider that consciousness is the great foundation, mystery, revelation, which makes this particular density possible, and I would say sensible. The sensibility, meaning ability to be sensed, of 3D, touch, taste, smell, sight, hearing, and the items of mind, memory, imagination, sensation, perception, thought, feeling. All of that experience is born of matrix of mind, consciousness, right? Consciousness itself is born of ignorance," said Gautama, the Buddha. "Therefore, at the level beyond higher self," actually, not higher self. Higher self is consciousness of oneness or oneness consciousness. "Beyond higher self is freedom from consciousness. Freedom from belief that consciousness is substantial, meaning real emptiness. Only above or with realization that consciousness is also ephemeral or flickering light and insubstantial, only then is there freedom from mind, freedom from belief in mind. But we can say the magician, as the worker of magic, is chosen, the name was chosen, the image, because consciousness is a mystery. What is magus, I will now send a file. Something strange that I thought recently. It's etymology of the word magnify. What a weird thing. So, what is the etymology of the word magnify? It ultimately comes from magus, and we can talk about it at the end if y'all get it. So, Ro, you may need to save as so it comes to you. Sophie got it. It's going to Ro now. Corinne got it. Billy's getting it. We can look at that at the end. But magnify comes from magnificare, or something like that. It means to make magus, to make a magician, to make the adept. To magnify is to make an adept. It's very interesting. We'll talk about it maybe in 15 minutes if you'd like. So, the name of magician is understandable when you consider that consciousness is both, you know, so Ra uses these terms. Consciousness is the great foundation, mystery and revelation, which makes it possible for us to experience 3D. 3D body, mind, spirit, 3D environment, and field. It's all in your mind, baby. It's all consciousness. And therefore, when consciousness is seen as a dream itself, it's all mind. Mind only was a school of Buddhism. The real awakening is awakening to the nature of creation and self. And that's a freedom from belief in consciousness, too. So we're talking about it while we're transcending it. Consciousness is a mystery. Consciousness is a revelation, a revealing, right? And consciousness is the foundation for our experiencing of the density. It may be, and so this is a very, I almost missed it. Here's a very, very important line. So, first Ra says, consciousness is the great foundation, mystery, revelation, which makes this particular density possible. Here's the line. The self-conscious entity is full of the magic of that which is to come. The self-conscious entity is full of the magic of that which is to come. Wow. What does it mean? It's not, that which is to come doesn't mean, you know, what's going to happen tomorrow and what I'm going to have for lunch later. It means that which is seen as ahead of us, that which is seen as greater than our position of consciousness now, that towards which consciousness is transmuting now, the transformational destination of consciousness is that which is to come. That transformational destination, or the destination of absolute, utter transformation, of knowing, right? The knowing. That transformative, the future coming, which is the potentia now. You know, all is all now. And so what is seen now is only a portion of all that is available for seeing now, that we will be seeing more and more in the now, which we could be considered that which is to come, but it's that which is of essence internally, or in terms of our true nature of awareness, but hasn't yet been actualized. The self-conscious entity is the one who's seeking the heart of self, you know? Reflection, but also aware that self is the universe. Self is a distorted field of light. separative, it seems, into body, mind, spirit fields, yet the same self manifesting through the forms of body, mind, spirit, right? These are just a triple energy field, which is form. It's just form. It's not you. But we have consciousness of it. The problem is that we identify with it. The self-conscious entity is the one that's conscious of itself, right? That's the human station, 3D. Seeking within. That is fullness, being full of the magic of that which is to come. That which is to come is inherently magical. Potentia. That which is to come is a phrase indicating linearity, the linear sequence of past, present, future. That can also be seen as that which is seen and that which is hidden. That which is manifest and that which is potential or potentia, not yet actualized. It's the hidden. It's the potentiator, right? The unconscious, the deep mind, the totality that we're not yet fully conscious of, or we're conscious of, but we can't manifest that consciousness. And so, that which is to come, or potentia, is full of magic. Potentia is full of magic. So, Ra says, it may be, meaning the matrix, may be considered first. For the mind is the first of the complexes to be developed by the student of spiritual evolution. So, at the head of the line is the conscious mind, the matrix of mind, the magician, the magus. And so the mind itself is magician because it manifests from the invisible. It uses catalyst for creation of experience. It develops consciousness and uses consciousness increasingly to manifest and actualize more of all that is. And so that's pretty interesting. Okay, our time is short, but I'd like to finish with this last question, which is a summary again of these body, mind, spirit, matrix, and potentiator relations or pairings. So I'm going to whittle down Don's question. He asks, could you expand even more upon the matrix of mind, potentiator of mind, and significator of mind, how they differ and what their relationships are, please? These are really big questions, you know, and he didn't understand that. I mean, he knew it was heavy, but he, you know, all these questions need to be hit again and again and again. You can't just ask it once and expect to get the total answer. You have to go into it again and again and again, you know, just the way waves lap at the shore. They're trying to get into the land, among other things, and they got to keep doing it. So, Ra answers, the matrix of mind is that from which all comes. Not the potentiator. The matrix of mind is that from which all comes. It is unmoving, yet it is the activator in potentiation of all mind activity. The potentiator of the mind, number two, is that great resource which may be seen as the sea, into which the consciousness dips ever deeper and more thoroughly in order to create, ideate, and become more self-conscious. The significator of each mind, body, and spirit may be seen as a simple and unified concept. The matrix of body may be seen to be a reflection in opposites of the mind, that is, unrestricted motion. The potentiator of the body, then, is that which, being informed, regulates activity. This is all high philosophy, and every word has to be etymologized, because each word is important here. The matrix of spirit, we're going from mind to body to spirit. The matrix of the spirit is difficult to characterize, since the nature of spirit is less motile, like sperm is motile, meaning zigzaggy. The energies and movements of the spirit are, by far, the most profound yet, having more close association with time-space, that's the point, do not have the characteristics of dynamic motion. Thusly, one may see the matrix as the deepest darkness, and the potentiator of spirit as the most sudden awakening, illuminating, and generative influence. This is the description of archetypes 1 through 9. Before the onset of influence of the co-creator or sublogos's sublogoic realization of free will. Now, archetypes 1 through 9 being the prevailed condition of 3D deep mind in the octave, the logoic octave creations before imposition of free will, right? Before the onset of influence of the co-creator or sub-logos, meaning the sun, the solar logoi, realizing free will. Oh, there's this thing called free will, which is to experience what is not. To experience the potentials of illusion. The archetypes 1 through 9 were therefore matrix potentiator significator of mind, matrix potentiator significator of body, matrix potentiator significator of spirit. 3, 6, 9. And any kind of sacred geometric nines, including the hermit, right, card number 9, could be understood in relation to this primary 9. I don't know if anybody listened to my cosmic numerics monologue, but 3 is the first geometric after 1, or the first purely relational geometric in cosmogenesis and the creation of self, the evolving self, right, was created by a triplicity. 7th density self, higher self, and body mind spirit complex. So anyway, this is talking about a 9. And so let me just summarize this. It's very nice, and we will come back to this paragraph in the future. The matrix of mind is that from which all comes, card 1, the magician. Excuse me. All comes from the matrix of mind, because all that we experience is a manifestation of consciousness. I'm aware of this. I, subject, verb, object. Subject, verb, object. The recognition that there is subject, verb, object, a me, an action, and an acted upon, that whole drama is born of consciousness. Were there no consciousness, or really, really no self-consciousness, there would be no recognition of those three players. Subject, object, and action. And so the Brahmanic phrase is, when the seer, the seen, and the mean, when the knower, the known, and the means to knowledge are unified, there is Brahman. Brahman. Now I eat a lot of Indian food, so I'm really getting it. So it means that the experience, the differentiated experience of subject, verb, object, me, doing or thinking upon that, or doing to that in a relationship, thinking about that in another mental relationship, that triad, that triplicity, that threefold experience of subject, verb, doing, action, and object is born of consciousness. And belief in the reality of consciousness, belief in the substantiality in consciousness, belief that our mind is telling the truth. There really is subject, verb, and object, right? Of course. What are you, crazy? Say they. So, all that experience comes from consciousness. But consciousness itself is unmoving. Now, it just is, right? I'm just conscious. There's just the light projected through the projector. The projection or light of consciousness is simply coming through. What it sees on the screen and how the players on the screen play is secondary. Primary is the shining light through the projector of mind-body-spirit complex. Consciousness, then, is unmoving. It's simply the field or screen of seeing. It's the perceptual screen upon which we differentiate experience. But it is also the activator in potentiation of all mind activity. Now, it's unmoving, but it's also the activator. It's an activator in potentiation. Aha! That's saying that the true nature of consciousness is unmoving. However, in potentia, by its deeper levels, the deeper levels of mind, that unmoving mind is a great activator potentially and can activate, move mountains, right? The conscious mind is the magician with the wand and the, you know, the four elements on the table to play. That is coming, using the of creation magically, creatively. But it itself isn't that way. It's impelled into that by activation or potentiation by the deeper mind. So we're just splitting hairs, in a sense, between the conscious mind and the impelling of the conscious mind by potentiator. Thus, therefore, the potentiator of mind is that great resource, a source again, another source, which may be seen as the sea. I see. It's the sea, into which consciousness dips ever more deeply and more thoroughly. Consciousness dipping more thoroughly into the potentiator of being. The potentiator of mind is, you know, ultimately the deep mind, which goes straight to the sixth chakra, you know. So the purpose of that dipping and that, you see, it's interesting. It's not a blasted tower. It's not a lightning bolt of potentiation. It's a dipping deeper. Dip, 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 dip. It's a thorough dipping into, a thorough swim and diving deep into the infinite potential of mind. The potential of mind is acted out by the potentiator of mind, the unconscious. The second source, another source, the resource, which is like a sea, an ocean, into which consciousness dips and swims and frolics in order to create and ideate, to ideate, to make idea, and become more self-conscious. Uh-huh. So the self-conscious entity is full of the magic of that which is to come. The self-conscious entity is full of the magic of that which is to come. by creative work, really, by being creative, by being receptive, by self-reflection, by contemplation, prayer, by meditation, by any kind of inner seeking. The magician, the magical conscious mind, becomes more self-conscious, right? A greater experience of selfhood. Next, we talk about the significator. Significator of each is a simple and unified concept. When we talk about body, the matrix of body is in some ways an opposite to the mind in that it's unrestricted motion rather than unmoving. Now what you see here is also sequencing. Positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative. Aha. That's how the cake is made. The cake is made by dissimilar elements sequenced. Sequencing of dissimilar, really polarized elements. Electrically polarized elements are sequenced one upon another. That's the body sandwich between mind and spirit. We'll talk more about that later. So matrix of body is in some ways an opposite of mind in that it is unrestricted motion. You know, you can say the monkey body, right? Potentiator of body then is wisdom, discernment, being informed. That which being informed, meaning going into form, regulates activity. Body form is entered by careful judgment or care, the quality of care, so that, you know, we don't hurt ourselves, we don't overtax ourselves, we don't get out of balance with body, we take care of body, you know? Take care of your horse. If you don't take care of your horse, you're going to be walking. Or you won't even be walking, you'll be laid up. So take care of your little buddy. I can't get into the chessboard in the first card, but the chessboard briefly in the first card, I believe, but we'll get into it, I'm not sure, I believe is that on the earth plane cube, consciousness has the option to go left or right, to go positive or negative, to have a polarized relation to the potentials of mind, the potentiator, in its creation, ideation, and becoming more conscious. How the consciousness creates and ideates and uses and directs its will and itself can be, is polarized in the 3D plane. Finally, the matrix of spirit is also not moving in a sense like mind, difficult to characterize. The nature of spirit is not so motile or moving about. The energies and movements of spirit are by far the most profound and powerful. Movements of the matrix of spirit, that's interesting, right? The subtle motion of the matrix of spirit. Most profound energies, yet having more close association with time-space. So we're talking really about sixth chakra, primarily the spirit complex, six and seven chakras. Matrix of spirit doesn't have characteristics of dynamic motion. You remember? Relatively fixed in space, but free in time. Quality of the after-death experience on the inner planes in time-space. Right, free in time, fixed in space, or experiencing it like that, comparable to the fixity or non-motility of the matrix of spirit. Thusly, one may see matrix of spirit as the deepest darkness, and that's why it was called the devil. Not because it's evil, but because it's dark. It's mysterium. It can't be seen. And the potentiator of spirit, which is lightning, is or as seen as the most sudden awakening, illuminating, and generative influence. Now, there is a resonance, which just appeared to me, between the creating, ideating, the creation, ideation, and increased self-consciousness of the potentiated matrix of mind with the awakening, illuminating, and generative influence of the potentiator of spirit into the spirit matrix. And this is very important. The creativity, ideation, and increased self-consciousness of the conscious mind, which is the matrix of mind, is resonant with and akin to the potentiation of spirit as a sudden awakening, illumination, and generative influence, which is generative meaning creative. So the potentiation of spirit is sudden awakening. Aha! Gnosis. Recognition of numinosity. Clarification of the darkness of you know, a lightning burst or lightning strike, a lightning flare in the darkness of the spirit, which is kind of the higher levels, you know, the level of higher self, which is mysterious to us, very subtle, you know. I mean, how can you experience creation as one, other than in a moment of, wow, it's all one? But I mean steady state. That's mysterious to us. That's dark. But the awakening of spirit is akin to the potentiation of mind. One is a dipping into the ocean, and the other one is a sudden fiery explosion of light, a short, sharp shock of light into awakening, which is an electrification, ultimately, of body, mind, spirit itself, the whole thing. And so, again, matrix, potentiator, and significator are the three primaries that existed before the veil. And they are one manifestation of the fundamental triplicity or triad of self that I talked about before. Okay, so that'll be it for today's reading. And that leaves us, we'll go into Q&A now, or discussion. So that leaves us in the middle of 16. Next week, we're going to start in the middle of page 16. And we will go further into the matrix of mind, the magician or consciousness, and discover really more about what consciousness is. You know, consciousness is a function, but it's also a quality of mind built that way. So very subtle. Anyway, thank you for today. I appreciate everybody's being here. Enjoy the evening. Talk to you next week. Take good care, and good night.